I'm Darrell Waltrip.
And I'm John Walsh.
Tomorrow, we'll bring you the great American race, the Daytona 500. But tonight, America's Most Wanted and NASCAR teaming up here in Daytona to bring you some high-speed justice.
You'll see me get behind the wheel of a police cruiser to learn the secrets of handling one of those bad boys in a high-speed chase. Then we'll go after the guys who use speed the wrong way. Fasten your seatbelts. The manhunt starts right now.
It's Saturday, February 17th, 2001. To date, your tips have led to the capture of 653 fugitives. Tonight on America's Most Wanted, America Fights Back. The race for justice is on. A promising NASCAR driver dies a mysterious death. And his killer gets away with murder.
There was no way we could prosecute the perpetrator for the crime of murder.
Find out why and join the victim's parents as they stand up and fight back. And
can I please see your ID and your ticket, please, sir?
For what? I haven't done anything.
When a wild man gets behind the wheel, speed kills. Also tonight, when outlaws are on the road, chasing them down could mean high speed.
Turned over and the truck just crashed.
And high risk. Now you'll learn the secrets the pros use in a high-speed chase.
They can't throw the steering wheel. They can't jam on the brakes. They can't smash the gas.
Tonight, we shift justice into high gear. Because tonight, America's Most Wanted is where America fights back.
Daytona International Speedway. Those cars out there are going almost 190 miles an hour. On the track, speed is king, but on the street, it can be bad news, especially when a criminal's trying to stay ahead of the law. That's why cops, just like race car drivers, have to learn how to rule the road. It can be the wildest moment in a cop's career and the most dangerous.
He just turned around, head on. Oh, they tried to ram him. They missed him.
Careening cars, near misses, and deadly crashes. All at speeds over 100 miles an hour.
Looks like they've...
Cops know many of those chases will end with a horrible accident.
There he goes.
Usually it's the suspect's vehicle.
There it is. That's it.
But as these photos show, many times it's the police officers who are seriously injured in pursuit of a runaway felon. Last year alone, 24 police officers were killed in automobile accidents, most of them during high-speed chases. That's just two less than the number of officers killed by guns.
They just jammed him.
With these alarming numbers, police departments are making learning to handle a car as important as learning to handle a gun. That's exactly what these Las Vegas cops are doing at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. But before they get behind the wheel, they have to make certain they know how to think behind the wheel, know when to pursue a suspect's vehicle, and when to lay off.
Okay, caution. Absolutely slow down. The faster you're going, the harder it is for you to see anything that happens, and we need to see everything that's going on around us.
While the cops in the classroom were getting up to speed on the rules of the road, I was getting personal instructions on high-speed urban pursuits from Officer Alan Wall. Alan not only has years of experience driving squad cars, but he also drives race cars in his spare time. And he let me in on his life-saving lessons.
Al, show me what you teach other police officers.
Okay, we're in a pursuit here, and behind the suspect vehicle, you want the suspect vehicle itself to be a blur. Your focus is out in front of him and back to the nose of the car, always watching where the nose of the car is pointed, which keeps you focused out in front and able to identify any hazards that might pop up.
So he's not just looking at the fugitive. He's got to be like a race car driver, looking ahead, looking for turns, looking for potential problems.
Absolutely. The look ahead's the number one thing. The eyes are the number one deficiency of any driver, not looking far enough ahead.
I find this fascinating. You try to teach him the skills, but so much of the problem is mental. You say that the adrenaline kicks in.
The mental end is so important, and it's something that is really hard to train. That adrenaline is just something else to control. They drop their guard, tunnel vision sets in, they let that element of surprise bite them, and they abuse the controls of the car and get in trouble. And skill-wise, they've got to put themselves on ice. They've got to be that gentle with all their controls when they're at those kind of speeds.
Put their skills on ice, meaning?
Meaning everything has to be in slow motion. They can't throw the steering wheel. They can't jam on the brakes. They can't smash the gas. They've got to be gentle with everything as if you were driving on ice.
After a few more times whipping around the track with Al, it was my turn to put into action the lessons I've learned.
Al, now you're going to teach me a few things, right?
Give it a shot.
What if I wreck your car?
Let's just go see what you got.
Okay.
The first thing I learned was that those squad cars can really move out. The second thing I learned was maneuvering the car between the cones. Not knocking one down is difficult. But the most important lesson I learned was driving at a high rate of speed is one tough job.
And if that's a tough job, imagine what it's like for these guys. They're driving twice as fast as I was, and they make it look so easy. Of course, in the Daytona 500, speed is a key to victory. And let me tell you, last week you guys were pretty fast too. Within a couple of hours of last week's show, you racked up not one, but two great captures.
Last Saturday night, our hotline was the place to be. The hotline was full of cops, and our show was full of bad guys that we wanted off the streets. By sunup, these two would be, thanks to viewer tips.
We had a lot of great tips coming in, and some were very precise. And at that point, we thought we'd get at least one capture, but we didn't think we'd get two.
The first to go down was Norman Aaron Tomley. Tomley was extremely drunk the night his pickup truck plowed into this Chevy Blazer. The fire killed three people. Three others in the SUV barely managed to escape. Tomley was convicted, but before he could serve any time, he hit the road.
Last name of Tomley, T-H-O-M-L-E-Y.
FBI agent Jim Reitler fielded the calls on Tomley. One by one, tips came in placing our fugitive in Mississippi using the alias John Higginbotham. Callers said he was working construction for Bigford Enterprises.
We had two tips on Tomley that said he worked for the same company, Bigford Enterprises. So we're very confident at that point. But then when the owner of Bigford Enterprises called in, then we knew we had our guy.
Supposed to be staying in the Park Place Hotel, room 146.
Agent Reitler alerted cops in Mississippi, who quickly descended on the Park Place Motel. Behind door 146, they found their man. At 1:01 a.m., cops had Aaron Tomley in custody.
He advised me on the way to jail that he was tired of running and that he was actually glad that it was over. Knew what he did was wrong and that he was ready to start paying for it.
He's not that pleasant to look at.
Hopefully within the next week.
Outstanding.
While that capture was going down, back at the hotline, Sergeant Dick Lowry from Georgia was working the Jarvis Thomas case. Thomas was wanted for a brutal home invasion robbery. Cops say he and his gang wore masks and used duct tape and an iron to terrorize their victims.
They're burning him! Oh, no!
Though their getaway ended in a dramatic wreck when all his cohorts were nabbed, Thomas slipped away. Tips on Jarvis Thomas came in from Modesto, California. Once again, the magic number was three. Three solid tips. Our alert viewers said that Thomas was still banging on doors, but this time he'd found a legitimate job. It involved appliances, but thankfully, not irons.
Jarvis Thomas was working in the Modesto area selling vacuum cleaners door to door.
Cops went to the address our tipsters gave them.
I was able to establish a phone conversation with Jarvis inside the apartment. At that time, Jarvis came out of the apartment and was taken into custody without any incident.
It just amazing. It just really just stunned me that for them to catch him so fast. Woo. They're just wonderful.
One night, two fugitives off the streets thanks to your calls.
That's great work. I really wanted to nail both of those guys, and we got them right away. Now, keep it parked right where you are. We'll be back with a lot more from Daytona.
Coming up next, terror in the suburbs, gun-toting masked man storm a home, and a family is terrorized and held hostage.
The 7-year-old daughter was taken and placed in a closet with this dynamite device strapped to her back.
But what were they after? You'll find out. And later. A famous driver's wife had a deadly premonition.
She says, the bad news is I'm afraid we're going to get killed.
Her nightmare came true. Then we take on the case.
Come on, people, let's grab some wingy. KFC's new spicy barbecue thingy. Little sweet honey make my tummy singy. Then smoked jalapeno on a long, slow stingy. Each one I eat, my bell goes dingy. Don't clip the last wing. Next time, bring your own. Today, 20 for $6.99, 8 for just $2.99. But not for long.
You give me for these?
Nah, I can't use these.
Come on, you can give me something.
No, I don't think so.
Will you work with me here? Make me an offer?
Let me think. No.
What will you do with all your old antacids now that there's new Pepcid Complete? It's the only one that starts to work in seconds and lasts 7 times longer than Tums, all with a single tablet. New Pepcid Complete. Just one, and heartburn's done.
She just doesn't understand me.
What's to understand? I mean, what is that, Michael?
Is that what you think I sound like?
Yes.
Mr. Doyle, do you use a cellular phone? What's come between you two is static. Here, Sprint PCS built the only all-digital, all-PCS nationwide network, so your calls are clear.
Thank you.
Sprint PCS, 2,000 minutes, all with nationwide long distance.
Fox Tomorrow, Springfield's most feared villain is back.
This time, I cannot fail.
Kelsey Grammer returns as Sideshow Bob.
What are you gonna do to me?
I have a plan. Have Bart kill Krusty.
Can nothing stop him?
Bart's a brainwashed killing machine.
So was I at his age.
An all-new Simpsons. Then, how could a routine traffic stop land Lois in the slammer?
Hey, Mom, is this a bad time to tell you I got kicked out of shop class?
All-new Malcolm after The Simpsons at 8, 7 Central tomorrow.
Tomorrow, a new era in motorsports begins as Fox Sports once again makes television history. The Daytona 500, coming tomorrow, 11:30 Eastern, 8:30 Pacific.
Your Dodge dealer is fired up about our return to Daytona. He's offering some tremendous deals during the Countdown to Daytona sales event, where we've just added special low 0.9% APR financing on the all-new Dodge Stratus, a Consumer's Digest Best Buy. Dodge is back at Daytona, and your Dodge dealers are behind this thing all the way.
We're in the garage area where they work on these amazing cars. They not only have to be fast, they have to be tough. Tough enough to last in a long race. And tough is the perfect word to describe the victim in our next case, because she had to endure a terrifying ordeal.
On a chilly November evening in Vista, California, just north of San Diego, a young single mother, we'll call Alicia, returned home with her 7-year-old daughter. They found a strange dog outside their house.
Okay, time for you to go home.
The dog was not lost. Its owner was hiding nearby and was about to turn Alicia's next 12 hours into a living nightmare.
They kicked the back door and came in, as the victim described, as like a SWAT team. They were all dressed in black. They all carried guns and had spears when they entered the residence.
The terrified mother and daughter were thrown on the ground and bound with duct tape. While the masked thugs continued to terrorize their victims, a fourth suspect stood guard outside and communicated with the abductors by walkie-talkie. Soon, they would have another hostage. Alicia's roommate returned home from a softball game and walked into the fight of her life. Now the terrorists had their three victims under control. Their next move was the last thing you might expect.
They then sit on the couch and they watch a video. It's the perfect storm.
As the night at the movies wore on, the hostages propped up in front of the TV set had no idea why they had been chosen as the target for this bizarre attack. But there was a reason. Alicia was the bank manager of a local Bank of America, and that was the real target. When morning came, the abductors began to put their plan into action.
The subjects told the manager that if she didn't comply with their wishes, that all three of them would be killed. And she was shown a detonating device. The manager had a dynamite device strapped on her back. The roommate had a dynamite device strapped on her back. The 7-year-old daughter was taken and placed in a closet with this dynamite device strapped to her back.
Then one suspect forced Alicia to drive to her bank while the other stayed at home with her roommate and child. In fear for her life, Alicia had no choice but to do what she was told, to get the money. After she handed over more than $360,000, her abductor forced her to drive a few blocks away and then fled. The bank manager rushed home and found her daughter and roommate alone and alive. The other terrorists were gone. Meanwhile, bank employees were calling the police.
911 emergency.
My manager has been held hostage.
So did she give you any description of these people?
She said that they came in with masks and guns and threw them on the floor.
As it turns out, part of the terrorist threat was a bluff. The dynamite wasn't real. As the three victims were recovering from their ordeal, cops quickly went after the armed robbers. It didn't take long for them to track down three of the suspects, including the woman who stood watch outside. But the man who owned the Rottweiler got away, and police say his name is Robert Ortiz.
Robert Ortiz has a violent temper and could explode at any given time.
In this Oceanside, California neighborhood where Ortiz lived, he and his dogs were well known.
He had two Rottweilers. One of them bit me right here.
Really?
But neither he nor his dog has been seen since the day of the robbery. Let's help cops find him tonight. Here's what we know. Robert Ortiz is also known as Bones. He has several tattoos, including this one on his chest that says Maria. He usually wears a goatee and a mustache, and he may be traveling with his dog, Voodoo. If you know where Ortiz is hiding, please call our hotline right now at 1-800-CRIME-TV.
Now we've got a late-breaking story out of Georgia, and our Rick Siegel has all the details.
Last Saturday night, an inmate at the jail in Stevens County, Georgia, was taken from his cell to the shower room after complaining that he was sick. The inmate was Dale Hayes, a man about to go on trial for two murders. Hayes was left in the shower room momentarily when a fight broke out in the prison.
The jailer come back and called Mr. Hayes' name. He did not answer. He opened the door and Mr. Hayes was not there. We suspect that Mr. Hayes came out this way and went through the visitation area. He came through this door and he went out this area and across the street to a construction company.
Once he reached the construction company, police say Hayes stole a truck and began driving west. The escape leaves Hayes' relatives in fear and his trial in limbo.
This is a death penalty case. Mr. Hayes is charged with two murders. We are ready for him to be brought back. We are ready to try him so that we can see that justice is done in this case.
The case dates back to 97, to crimes committed in the wee hours of the morning while Hayes' father and stepmother slept in their home.
Dale Hayes and a relative arrived at the mobile home, cut the phone line, forced their way in. Dale Hayes went to the bedroom where he used a knife and brutally killed both people. It was the most chilling sight that I had seen in my years in law enforcement. There was blood everywhere. This was a long, drawn-out process that probably went on close to an hour, where he talked to them and told them what he was going to do, gave them a choice on how they were to die. It made it plain to both of them before he left there that both of them were going to die.
And police say the killings were the result of a custody battle over the victim's 7-year-old daughter, who was in the trailer at the time.
What hurt so bad about it was that their daughter, who was in the same house, was hearing everything that was going on. And that's going to be, will be with her as long as she lives.
Police say Dale Hayes was last seen Sunday morning outside of Montgomery, Alabama, and he may still be driving the stolen truck, a white 1991 Chevy pickup with Georgia plates and the name Tugelo Construction Company on the doors. If you have information about the whereabouts of Roger Dale Hayes, call us tonight at 1-800-CRIME-TV.
Up next, the cops want to take him in.
Can I please see your ID and your ticket, please, Joe?
But he's not going, no matter what's in his way.
No, I'm the concierge.
Urge?
Urge! She's got the urge! She's got the urge to herbal. Natural botanical. She's got the urge! She's got the urge to herbal.
All that singing and dancing, and you didn't even try the styling line. Come here!
Good evening, Batman.
Alfred.
I've stepped up safety in the Batmobile, sir.
Really?
Should a villain steal it, someone will track it. If your airbag goes off, an advisor will assist you. If you're stranded, satellites will help locate you.
And where have you put all these things?
Just press the OnStar button, sir.
Well done, Alfred.
My pleasure, sir.
OnStar, how can I help you, Batman?
The week before my periods,
what does it look like?
I'd get super moody.
I'd cry over anything. And couldn't be around anyone.
That time of the month, nothing ever fit.
Think it's PMS?
Nothing.
Think again.
Everything. I don't know.
If you suffer from many of these symptoms month after month, and they clearly interfere with your daily activities and relationships,
leave me alone.
You could have PMDD, premenstrual dysphoric disorder. A distinct medical condition. It causes intense mood and physical symptoms right before your period. But fortunately, you can do something about it. We at Eli Lilly and Company encourage you to talk to your doctor. You can also learn more about PMDD, its symptoms, and treatment options at WebMD.com. Take control and make informed decisions about your health. Why live this way another month?
This year, Metabolife introduced two innovative new products, our meal replacement shakes and our diet and energy bars. We understood these advanced and revolutionary products would change the way people viewed weight management, but the demand far exceeded our ability to manufacture. If you're having trouble finding our new products, please keep looking, because I want to personally assure you that Metabolife is working day and night to meet the demand. This is Metabolife's commitment to you.
Sometimes you want them to be perfectly pressed. But for the other 95% of their lives, there's Downy Wrinkle Releaser. Just spray, tug, and smooth. It's the casual press for casual dress.
Everyone knows good teachers are hard to find.
Six teachers quit.
But how far will one principal go to change education forever?
This is beyond irresponsible.
If you want my job, go see the superintendent.
All new, the hit series Boston Public. Then, 4 years ago, they shared a secret night of passion. Now, will Ling be able to resist?
Do you want to grab some dinner?
The firm's newest lawyer. An all-new Ally McBeal. It all starts at 8, 7 Central, Fox Monday. Over 57 million viewers have made Temptation Island a television phenomenon. What could possibly make it even hotter? With only two episodes left, we've saved the best for last.
It's much more serious. It's down to three guys and three girls.
When the couples embark on their final and most intimate dates.
He is even more than I expected.
Don't miss the most provocative episode yet.
I have a visual of who he's spending 2 days with.
Temptation Island returns at 9, 8 Central, Fox Wednesday.
This case is about a guy who acted like a high roller. In fact, he was a cab driver and a tour guide. He was also a convicted sex offender. When he gambled with his judgment, he rolled snake eyes with a lot of people's lives.
It was December 11th, 2000, when police say Magfour Mansour spotted a young woman at a Las Vegas bus stop. She was alone, and police say this gambler took advantage of the opportunity.
That's not the answer I wanted. Now get into the car. Get into the car. Get into the car, lady. Get into the car. Get in. Shut up. Shut up.
Police say after Mansour kidnapped the girl, he sexually assaulted her. Then they say he did his best to disappear.
Mansour's wife, she stated that when she got in the apartment, just about everything he owned was gone. His clothes, any letters he had, any pictures of him. He cleaned the apartment out of any trace that he was even there.
Police believe after Mansour left Las Vegas, he went to Reno, Nevada, then to Indian casinos in Connecticut and Florida, as well as gambling riverboats in New Orleans. And on January 9th, police say Mansour was in the New Orleans airport buying a ticket. His nervousness and strange wardrobe, a wig and a black knit cap, caught the attention of several people.
Yes, sir, we need your name and some identification.
Actually, I've got my ID in my bag. I'll be right back.
Mansour's odd behavior and appearance continue to raise suspicions. That's when undercover detective Lieutenant Keith Simone was contacted.
As I'm receiving a description of this guy, I see him walking through the lobby, and he walked directly out the first set of exit doors.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
That's when I went behind him, identified myself, and asked to speak with him for a moment.
For what? I haven't done anything. There's no problem. I just need to see your ID right now, please.
When I grabbed the jacket, he started spinning around, struggling.
Police were on the alert for the stolen truck when a sheriff's deputy spotted Mansour outside New Orleans.
Suspect spotted in gold Ford F-250 in pursuit.
Tragically, highway worker Leroy Williams died as a result of his injuries. As for Mansoor, incredibly, police believe he escaped by jumping into the Mississippi River and swimming away. He hasn't been seen since. Mansoor speaks several languages, including Italian and German. He sometimes goes by the alias Francis Gabriel. He changes his appearance often by growing a beard or goatee. Mansoor is a compulsive gambler, preferring blackjack and craps, and is probably somewhere near a casino tonight. So if you've seen Mag4 Mansoor, it's time to tell him his number is up by calling our hotline at 1-800-CRIME-TV. Mansoor, you're spinning way out of control. But don't worry, we're going to set you straight. Straight to jail where you belong. Now, a few weeks ago, you helped us take down the Texas 7. In 150 years, only one convict has escaped from a Texas prison and stayed out there. And you know what? There's only one thing to do. Let's go get him.
Everybody remembers significant events where they were in their life when things happened. I know exactly where I was on April the 2nd of 1995.
How could he forget? That's the day this bullet almost killed Houston Police Sergeant Jim Binford. He caught it in the crossfire of a gunfight with this man, Jose Salas. Cops say Salas and an accomplice kidnapped a bartender from this nightclub and demanded a $5,000 ransom. The money exchange was to go down at noon in this parking lot. Houston police were waiting undercover.
The suspects came in. They had a gun to the head of the hostage. We were able to buy the hostage back. The suspects got the money. A gun battle broke out. During the process of that gun battle, I was shooting the crook that was driving and was shooting at us. I was hit with a bullet in the right flank, my side here, in the kidney side.
But he didn't go down without a fight. Jim was able to shoot Salas four times with his 12-gauge shotgun. Amazingly, that didn't stop Salas, who kept shooting back despite his wounds.
In 31 years of being a policeman, I can't remember a more evil sight of that man cursing me as he was trying to kill me.
Salas continued firing at cops until he was finally stopped when he slammed into a Houston police cruiser. Salas got a life sentence for trying to kill the officers. He was sent to the Garza East Prison in Beeville, Texas, but he wouldn't stay here for long. Unlike the Texas 7 who planned their escape for months, Salas was able to take advantage of a random opportunity one foggy night in March 1997.
His particular dorm had been on the rec yard. As they came back in, the rec officer closed the door and for some reason it failed to secure all the way.
Salas bolted through the door and headed straight for the fences.
The first fence he went over was the recreation yard fence, approximately 12 feet high, with razor wire at the top. She goes over the first strand of barbed wire, this fence here, jumps off, lands down here in this area.
Salas shielded himself from the punishing razor wire with his coat. But that was just the first obstacle. Two more vicious barriers lay ahead of him.
Runs to the first inner perimeter fence, scales that fence, jumps down, climbs and scales the third fence that you see over there, which is the outer perimeter fence. Once he gets over that fence, they see him running for about 40 to 50 yards. And that was the last we had any sight of it.
It's been 4 years since Jose Salas vanished into the night. Texas officials are determined not to let him break their perfect record. And you can help bring him in. Here's what to look for. Salas probably still has faint scars on his face from the gunfight with cops. He also has gunshot scars on both legs. Salas has the letter J tattooed on his left hand. And cops think he might be hiding out in Mexico or Houston. If you know where Jose Salas is tonight, give us a call at 1-800-CRIME-TV.
Salas, we caught the Texas 7, and now we're going after you. You may think by now you're in the free and clear, but I got news for you. You're going down. Now stay with us. We got a lot more from Daytona.
Up next. Everyone loved Mickey Thompson, so why did someone want him dead?
I'm Michael Goodwin, and I don't kill people.
Your Dodge dealer is fired up about our return to Daytona. He's offering some tremendous deals during the Countdown to Daytona sales event, where it's just been announced that you can get the just right size Dodge Durango and get just right savings with 0.9% financing. Dodge is back at Daytona, and your Dodge dealers are behind this thing all the way.
They've got his style. They've got his moves. They've got a plan. Kurt Russell.
Let's do it.
Kevin Costner. 3,000 miles to Graceland. Rated R. Starts this Friday.
Bite into the cheesy gordita crunch and you'll be rocked by a crunchy taco wrapped in warm flatbread with a melted three cheese blend and spiked with a zesty pepper jack sauce. The cheesy gordita crunch, only at Taco Bell.
Nothing's worse than being wet. That's why babies like to be in Pampers Baby Dry. Its super absorbent core helps give your baby superior dryness. Pampers, protecting every step of the way.
You know them from the X-Files. Ow! Now they're out on their own.
I gotta say, so far this job sucks.
The Lone Gunman, coming this March to Fox.
Honey, it's okay. You're eligible for RightCare health coverage.
I had no idea.
Without health insurance, medical bills add up. We're eligible. I had no idea.
They look great.
I had no idea how well we would be treated by the Neighborhood Health Plan of Rhode Island.
I think you're extreme. What's extreme? You don't know. Until you fly freestyle. By FMA Freestyle Motocross, with the top riders in the nation, you've seen it at the Gravity Games. And now, for the first time ever, it's nothing but freestyle live in the Civic Center. And kid seats are just $10. So get tickets now at Racy Motorcycle Center, March 2nd and 3rd, Providence Civic Center.
You don't have time for everything. We know that. Fox 64 News at 10. The news you need at a time that works for you.
The time is right.
The Chili Cook-Off Championship is on the line. Can Homer regain his title?
Steam should be shooting out of his ears.
His ears if we're lucky.
The Simpsons.
Monday at 6 on Fox 64.
Get your future guest from meteorologist TJ Del Santo tonight on Fox 64 News at 10.
Coming up tonight on Fox 64 News at 10, a new discovery and new developments in the submarine collision with a Japanese fishing boat off the coast of Hawaii. Plus, a tragic fire in Lincoln leaves residents there in disbelief. We'll hear what they have to say about the loss of a close friend. And police around the country are on the watch for two Vermont teens wanted for the murders of two college professors.
In Rhode Island and southeastern Massachusetts, you're watching Fox 64, WNAC-TV, Providence, New Bedford.
Frazier's got a caring father.
I got my kids in the car!
A devoted brother.
I would shave my head for you. Gesture which becomes less significant with each passing year.
And dear Daphne, the fun's all relative on Frazier.
We're an odd little family.
Weeknights at 7:30 on Fox 64.
The NASCAR joyride at top speed. At night isn't for everyone.
I'd rather have hemorrhoid surgery.
And only at Titus at 8:30 Fox Tuesday.
Fight back. It might save your life. We're here in Victory Lane at the Daytona International Speedway, the very spot where all the great drivers want to be tomorrow after they finish that 200-lap race. Our next story is about a great driver who spent a lot of time in Victory Lanes all over the country, but his murder still remains a mystery. Our Tom Morris has the story.
From drag racing in the 1950s
to off-road racing and land speed records in the 60s, Mickey Thompson always wanted to be the fastest and the best. Competition, innovation, and determination drove Mickey to break nearly 500 speed records. Week after week, year after year, thousands poured into stadiums across the country to see what Mickey had in store for them.
He wins! Thompson has taken the win! Unbelievable!
Mickey was a racing legend, but the speed, the cars, and the innovations all took a back seat to one thing, his marriage to Trudy.
Mickey and Trudy were really good together. They were so cute together, and they were so much fun together. She was my best friend, and a great sister, and a very devoted wife to Mickey.
Life was cruising along for Mickey. Then in 1984, he asked this man, Michael Goodwin, to help run his racing promotions company. But after just 3 months, the partnership crumbled, and a lengthy court battle ensued. In the end, Mickey Thompson emerged victorious with a judgment of more than $500,000, but he also became the target of death threats.
Trudy called me one day and she said, "Hey sis, I got good news and I got bad news." She says, "Well, the good news is the Supreme Court refused to hear the appeal for Mike Goodwin on Mickey's case." And I says, "Fantastic." But she says, "The bad news is, Colleen, I'm afraid we're gonna get killed."
Trudy's feelings couldn't have been more horribly prophetic. This is video of Mickey Thompson outside of his California home, the same home where Mickey and Trudy were ambushed on March 16, 1988.
There's indications from the way the initial assault took place. Mickey was shot first, and it wasn't a fatal wound. And then the focus of the assault went to Trudy.
I saw Trudy on the ground. The guy had a gun over Trudy, and I heard Mickey say, "Please don't hurt my wife." And he fired and hit and killed Trudy in front of Mickey.
Then he was killed. It seemed very personal and vindictive. They were there to do one thing, and that was to kill him. And it also appears that they had somewhat of a plan. They had the bicycles for escape. The bicycles gave him a certain speed and mobility to leave the scene.
Police say these two neighbors are the only ones who actually saw the killer's faces. So we asked renowned forensic artist Gene Boylan to work with them to draw composite sketches of Mickey and Trudy's killers. Within hours, she had her first sketch.
Ready? Okay. So, that's good. Yeah, that's it.
So I'm going to show you the rough draft now, and I want your opinion of how this is. We can change anything on here. You ready?
Ready. That's him. It gives me the chills to see it. That's him.
Police have been hoping these sketches will help catch the killers, who investigators suspect were hired hitmen. They also want to know who hired them. It's important to note that no charges have ever been filed against Michael Goodwin, although police say he is still their main suspect.
The civil suit actually resulted in Goodwin's house being seized, his car, Mercedes, being seized, essentially his contract and his sport being taken over by Thompson. And some people feel that this could have pushed him over the edge.
It's an allegation Goodwin has always denied.
If I was involved, they would have had me by now. Okay, I wasn't involved. I'm Michael Goodwin, and I don't kill people. It's not part of my nature.
Goodwin was serving time in federal prison for bank fraud when he gave us this interview in 1997. He was released a year later, and today still owes the Thompson estate $1.1 million from the lawsuit. It's been 12 years since Mickey and Trudy were gunned down, but police haven't stopped searching for their killers. And that's where you can help tonight. Take another look at these sketches. And remember, this murder happened in 1988, so these men will look somewhat different today. If you have any information on this case, call us now at 1-800-PRIME-TV.
Colleen Campbell, Mickey Thompson's sister, has never given up her fight to bring justice to this family. She's put up $1 million reward to find the murderers of Mickey and Trudy Thompson. So please, let's get some closure for this family. If you know anything at all about this case, please have the courage to make that call. And if you want to learn more about the Mickey Thompson case or any of our cases, please visit our website at amw.com. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Coming up next, the death of a NASCAR star. Find out why his killer got away with murder.
I had to inform the Trickles that there was no way we could prosecute the perpetrator for the crime of murder.
Could the same thing happen in your state?
Bobby becomes a ventriloquist.
Oh, God.
Is Hank mad enough to deal with it?
My son is playing with dolls. There, I said it.
He's a sissy. There, I said that.
King of the Hill, all new at 7:30, 6:30 Central tomorrow on Fox. Oh.
The world is a beautiful place, but not when your eyes feel dry, gritty, irritated. Protect them with Refresh brand eye drops. Refresh is no ordinary eye drop. First, Refresh relieves dryness. Then Refresh forms a lasting shield of protection that keeps irritation out and moisture in. So get relief and protection with the number one brand recommended by eye doctors. Refresh. It relieves and protects. And protects and protects.
Hi, girls.
Lewis, have you tried this yet?
Stovetop Oven Classics? Had it last week.
How'd it taste?
Good, real good. Just like the Sunday dinners you used to make.
Stovetop Oven Classics. Sunday taste, Tuesday effort.
There are lots of ways to equip a car. And right now, when you buy a new 2001 Chevy Cavalier, we'll give you $2,500 cash back. So you can equip your Cavalier any way you like.
Bonus.
The $2,500 Chevy Cavalier bonus. Residency restrictions apply. Call for details and see your Chevy dealer before it ends February 28th.
Come on, boy!
Bart's Butterfingers, so butterfingery.
Hit a homer, dude!
No! Crispity Crunchity Butterfinger from Nestle.
Nobody better lay a finger on my Butterfinger.
Police in Arkansas say Kevin Tosh shot and killed a man at a birthday party. He may be in the Texas area. Call 1-800-CRIME-TV if you've seen him.
With only two episodes left, the couples go on their most intimate dates.
I have a visual of who he's spending 2 days with.
Temptation Island at 9, 8 Central, Fox Wednesday.
Why is our house the newest teen hangout? Because we just got that really fast internet service. Because we have over 240 channels and a second phone line. Because we've got everything in one simple package that only Cox offers.
Now get digital cable, high-speed internet, and local and long-distance phone service together in one affordable package from Cox.
Call Cox Communications now to get one free month of any Cox service that you don't have, plus special savings on installation.
Cox Communications. Now you're living.
Oh, baby, that's the one.
Who's that? You talking to me? Ooh la la.
Oh, if I could only have you.
If a new car is what you want, the Loan Arranger can help you get it.
Worry about your credit situation no more. Bad credit, bankruptcy,
no problem.
The Loan Arranger works with real banks with a 95% approval rate.
Most definitely.
Who is the Loan Arranger?
The Loan Arranger will get you pre-approved for a car loan before you go to buy. Get the credit you deserve.
John and Calvino Law Associates work together, dedicated to our client satisfaction through hard work and commitment. We help you get through the legal process quickly and professionally. Confidence in the law firm you choose is essential. John and Calvino Law Associates, 785-9400.
Tomorrow, the biggest event in all of motorsports comes to Fox. The Daytona 500 tomorrow at 11:30 Eastern.
Who is the father of Scully's baby?
I wouldn't want this to come between us.
Is it a miracle or a terrifying mystery?
There's something I haven't told you.
I don't believe this.
The X-Files. David Duchovny returns in an all-new episode tomorrow.
Our next story is about a young driver who tragically never lived to fulfill his promise on the track. But his lasting legacy may have a far greater effect than any race car drivers ever have.
Okay, Chris Trickle in victory lane here.
Chris Trickle was a rising star on the fast track to success on the NASCAR circuit.
Hey, it's better than sitting home watching football.
Chris was very successful at a young age because of his personality. You know, and I'm sure you've met people that you walk into a room and there's 20 people, but there's somebody stands out. And that's how he did around people.
Chris Trickle could handle a hairpin turn at high speeds, but on February 9th, 1997, for some reason he couldn't control his convertible on a deserted Las Vegas road.
We think maybe there was a traffic altercation of some sort. We're not sure.
A mysterious ponytailed man was the first on the scene, and he quickly flagged down a bus full of tourists who were headed for the casinos.
This has been an accident.
But luck was on Chris's side, because one of those vacationers was surgeon Sandra Clancy.
When I got to the car, I could see that the person inside was very seriously injured. I then asked my husband to help me get the injured fellow out of the car because he wasn't breathing very well.
I recall thinking at the time, gosh, this just doesn't seem like that type of an accident, the type that would cause this sort of an injury.
While the Clancys tended to Chris, the man with a ponytail simply walked away.
We need to talk to him. We need to find out what he saw. And he may be just a witness. We don't know at this time, but we definitely need to talk to him.
The detectives would become more desperate to talk to the man because once Chris was taken to the hospital, they found out why he'd driven off the road and why his injuries seemed so severe. Chris had been shot in the head and was left in a coma.
When things happen, you know, that tears your heart out. It comes to the front of you and tears your heart out. This one here tears your heart out from the back because it's so unnecessary.
It's where America fights back.
2 months later, when we brought you Chris's story, the call we'd been hoping for came in. Ponytailed man in the composite made the call himself. Detectives flew to California to interview him, but he knew little about the accident. The investigation was at a standstill. Meanwhile, Chris was clinging to life. In and out of the coma, he often showed signs that he was going to survive.
About a week and a half ago, we were in his room, and his girlfriend, as she usually does, called, and she was talking to him, not expecting any response. And just when she stopped for a second, and he said very clearly, "I love you."
We're going to see some bumps in this road, and we believe we're going in the right direction.
But tragically, on March 25th, 1998, 13 months after the shooting, those hopes were dashed.
Tried to get the IV and he never did get it, and he vomited, and then he choked on his own vomit, and he died right in front of him, my wife and his girlfriend.
Lord, as we gather here together to say goodbye to our very good friend, a great individual, a fantastic young man. Chris has completed his journey. He's left a fantastic memory.
Detectives were now investigating a homicide, or were they? A little-used Nevada law would make the Trickles' sad situation downright unbearable.
The day he died, I had to inform the Trickles that there was no way we could prosecute the perpetrator for the crime of murder because of the year-and-a-day law.
Nevada's year-and-a-day law, a relic of time, before medical science could link a death to an old injury. Simply put, since Chris died more than a year and a day after the shooting, police could not charge the gunman with murder. Right then and there, the Trickles made the decision not to remain victims and to ensure that something like this could never happen again in Nevada.
It don't make sense, and somebody snuck that one through. That'll change.
The Trickles held on to the hope that the killer would be found and charged with attempted murder.
3 years to the day after the shooting, a TV reporter showed up on their doorstep with more bad news.
She says, you know that the man can't be tried for attempted murder or anything. He's scot-free. The year-and-a-day thing was bad, but this was worse. This was the final straw.
Detectives now couldn't even charge the killer with attempted murder because the three-year statute of limitations had lapsed. Whoever shot Chris Trickle had gotten away with murder.
Why my son has to take all the beating? Why can't he be helped? And it's like we wanted to give up, but no, we didn't.
What the Trickles did was contact their state senator, Dina Titus.
What's the police department's feeling about it? Well, I mean, can we...
She knew right away that something needed to be done.
Not only was the person killed, but you couldn't go after the person who killed him. That just seems a travesty of justice.
So Senator Titus, working with the Trickles, proposed the Chris Trickle bill, aimed at abolishing the year-and-a-day law.
The year-and-a-day rule does not conform to present-day medical realities, principles of equity, or public policy. This issue was brought to my attention last year with the death of Chris Trickle. I would urge you to pass Senate Bill 11, which should be known as the Chris Trickle Bill.
The Trickles spoke next. Chuck and Barbara, via closed circuit in Las Vegas, told the Senate across the state in Carson City what the Chris Trickle law meant to them.
He won't be held accountable for Chris's death, and that's not fair, it's not right, and it's very frustrating for us. But we would like to, as Senator Titus had said, make this Chris's legacy.
We've got to get these people off the streets. Senator Titus has helped us through it and explained it. If this can be passed, this will be a great thing for Chris Trickle.
And any questions on the motion? All those in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed? None. The motion carries unanimously. It's due pass. Senator Titus will take it to the floor. All right. We thank the Trickle family again.
A month later, the Chris Trickle bill became the Chris Trickle law. Finally, something had gone right for the family that had suffered so much. I recently met the Trickles in the one location Chris felt most at home, on the racetrack. We can't understand why anybody would murder our children, but we wanted to make sure they didn't die in vain. So I'm proud of you, and I'm sure that Chris is looking down from heaven at you and proud of his parents. Never picked up a gun, but with the help of the American public and law enforcement, we've caught 650 guys. It's been unbelievable.
That's great.
So we're still battling.
Listen to you. See, I can listen to you, but I can't listen to these people that don't know. I can feel what you're saying.
Right.
And it was very hard for me. People come and say that to me, I walk away from them.
Right.
Like you say, you have to walk in the same shoes, and unfortunately, we do.
Right.
And we hope nobody else ever has to do it.
God bless you. But our work here isn't done. There are several states that still have some form of the year-and-a-day law, including California, Idaho, South Carolina, Alabama, Connecticut, Indiana, Kentucky, Mississippi, Nebraska, Oklahoma, Tennessee, and Virginia, 12 states where someone can still get away with murder. You know, the Trickles are what America's Most Wanted is all about. In the face of tragedy, they rose above their pain and did something to make sure that what happened to them will never happen again, at least not in their state. So now I have a challenge for all of those states that still have this horrible year-and-a-day law on their books. Get rid of it. It's old, it's outdated, it needs to be abolished before another family has to experience the double heartache the Trickles had to endure. Now here's a quick review of tonight's cases. LA police believe Robert Ortiz took a family hostage as a part of a bank robbery plot. He goes by the name Bones and may be traveling with a pet Rottweiler. Magfor Mansour is wanted for rape, kidnapping, and murder. He's a gambling addict, speaks German and Italian, and uses the alias Francis Gabriel. In Georgia, police are looking for Roger Hayes, who escaped from prison. Jose Salas broke out of the Garza East prison in Beeville, Texas. He may be traveling back and forth between Houston and Mexico. Police in Arkansas are looking for Kevin Ta. They say Ta was attending a birthday party when he shot two men during an altercation. One of the men died. And authorities in California are looking for the killers of Mickey and Trudy Thompson. The couple was shot to death in the driveway of their home. These sketches are of two suspects who fled on bicycles. I'm John Walsh. Thanks a lot for watching. And remember, you can make a difference.
This is Danielle North, straight ahead on Fox 64 News at 10. The nationwide manhunt is on for two New England teens wanted for murder. We'll have the details of this complex investigation. Plus, this building came down today. It's the scene of another fire tragedy that has shaken the community of Lincoln this weekend. And there's new information and a new discovery in the continuing investigation of the submarine collision with a Japanese vessel. Fox 64 News at 10 is next.